The argument that I deal with is the question of how do we know in our business what makes the biggest impacts on kids? And so I've spent quite a few years, 20 or 30 years, squirreling away. That's a good used word to use in Toronto. Squirreling away, that's the first time I met them, to find evidence that I could put along this continuum. Now, I have this argument that I can put them along this continuum and I can also have a measurement consideration. My PhD was in measurement, so that gives me some permission to do this. And the question I have used often to start this question is this one, a very hot topic. And when I take the hundreds of studies and about a million kids and 50,000, 70,000 teachers, it turns out the average effect of reducing class size is 0.2. And it's like a 0.5 of a year gain. If it was one, which it's not, it would be a 3-year gain. And my fundamental argument is the null hypothesis, that that's the problem in our business. We constantly want to look at what the effect is of what we do compared to what doesn't happen. We ask teachers the crazy question, can you show us what the kids' performance at the beginning of the year is like, and then can you show what it's later on? And if it's improved, you've done a great job. Crazy. The reason? Wrong comparison. We should not be comparing to the zero point. Instead, we should be saying, compared to all the influences that we have on kids, from the home, from the school, from the policies, from the finances, from the teachers, from the strategies, from the homework, you name it. If I can collect all those, and I've just passed 1,000 meta-analyses around 250, 260 million kids, can I collectively put them together to ask that really critical question to me, what's the average effect? And yes, I can. And so you can see that class size is tiny compared to all the other things we do. It's positive, but it's tiny. But of all the things I've learned over the years, I can show it in this graph here with the 250 million kids. In the red zone, the influences that negatively influence. Hardly anything we do to kids harms them. 95 to 97% of things that we do to kids enhances their achievement. Every teacher that says to you, look at their performance at the start of the year, look at it later, every teacher can do that. Anybody out there in the community think they can do better? They can. Any politician who wants to have any policy what they like, we can give absolute permission to Mary Jean and Ben, they can do what they like because it will work. Because you can see 95 to 98% are greater than the zero point in the purple and green zone. And that's why I think our business is in trouble. That's why we constantly get criticized. That's why we constantly get told you're not doing good enough. Because we could do better. And if we set the bar that low, everybody can. And I was horrified last October when England passed their Conservative Party government passed their policy on teacher education, and one half of it was that if you worked in the ministry, you automatically could be a teacher. Now, my reaction, but no worse than anyone else, if all we want to argue is that we're enhancing achievement. Of course, you can see it's kind of like a normal distribution of all the effects. And they centre around, on this particular scale, which isn't that critical for this moment, they centre around that 0.4 notion. And my argument is that's what we should be using as our litmus test. That should be our hinge point. That should be the point around which we ask what works. On average, let me give you a hint. When I analysed the No Child Left Behind data, the NAEP data in the US, the NAPLAN equivalent in Australia, the ASTON equivalent in New Zealand, and the SATs in England, and I asked the question, what's the average growth that a kid gets per year? It's exactly that number. So from both the research on influences of achievement, plus all the data I have from all the standardized tests, and maybe one day I'll get to EQAO and look at that data, but I think I don't need to do it. I have a hunch that we should expect every kid has the right to expect at least a 0.4 growth on the scale per year. And hey, we can do it. And many, 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 many teachers and schools out there do it. And my problem in this business is those teachers in the purple zone. And my simple test, parents, would you want your kid in a class with a teacher who systematically gets greater than average growth? Or do you want your teacher down the corridor, kid down the corridor with a teacher who systematically gets lower? That's the business. Now, if I had to stop there, I think that, in terms of my modesty, would like to say that is a contribution that we can have to ask, what is sufficient? What is good enough? And one of the problems I have in education is we always ask for more of our schools and teachers. And my argument is, if you can systematically get greater than a year's growth for a year's input, I think that's stunning. I want to esteem it, I want to bottle it, I want to understand it, and I want more of it. But if you systematically get less than 0.4, you have no rights, you have no autonomies to continue to do that and do that harm. So that's the problem. Now, what I went into next is the story. And what is the story underlying the green zone with the purple zone? And I'm not that interested in the red zone. It's a false argument to say bad teachers do harm, because there's hardly anyone out there that does harm, if you set zero. But if you set 0.4, you can see the population is a little larger. Now, this is not the time to do it, but the way I do it is I go through whole lots of things, and I'm not going to go through them all today, I'm just going to give you a bit of a flavour. From things at the bottom that hardly make a difference, you can see they're well below 0.4. And one of the things I discover is a lot of those things at the bottom of the chart are structural things, the way we structure schools and finance schools and people schools and structure classes, timetabling, all that stuff. All the stuff we love to talk about that doesn't make a difference. And yes, every one of these is important, and yes, every one of them I go into. And some of them I'm very unhappy about. I'm particularly unhappy about teacher subject matter knowledge. It doesn't matter. It should matter. And what I'm discovering is that if classroom behaviour changes, teacher subject matter goes up. It's not. We should go out and have teachers have more subject matter knowledge. It has made no effect whatsoever. You can see it. And so on. So there's lots of issues in each of these, but give you a bit of a flavour there. Let me give you another sense. I'm going up on it. I only got about four or five of these, and I just want you to get a flavour, because the question is, what's the story? And certainly, as I've suggested at the bottom of the chart, it's the stuff that we like to talk about in schools, amongst our teachers, amongst our population, in our newspapers, and our policies. Because we can see them when you build a building, when you count the number of people. But you can see where they fall. Getting up a bit. And I put that principals and school leaders who are slightly below the mean, not trivially so, just to bait these two guys. I'm sure we'll come back to that. But partly, I'm kind of not interested in any of those things too much. Quite frankly, if you want to debate some of those things, go into another room and waste someone else's time. Bit strong, but that's the bottom half. Let's go above the 0.4. Now, what's the story? I keep coming back to that because it's not the data. And one of the mistakes that I've unfortunately been culpable in is when people read my work, they say, oh, that's at the top, let's do that. And they miss the point. Because some of the things at the bottom should be higher. And the story to me comes back to this notion of challenge. How do we know how to appropriately challenge kids? And let me give you a kind of a metaphor. How many of you have been addicted at some stage to Angry Birds? Yeah. Good analogy. Now, when you play those kind of computer games, they know exactly what your prior learning is. They also know that they have to set a challenge sufficiently above your prior learning to tempt you to try and get there. It's too high, you won't do it. It's too easy, you give up. And then they pour in the feedback information to help you get there. And if you're like me, who gets addicted to these things, you then go up on the web and you look, how do I pass level 4 of whatever it is in the thing, and you get help and assistance. That's the metaphor. If we can help our students understand and our teachers understand what prior learning is, and you know the killer is, in any one class, it can be quite dramatically different. If we can then help kids understand what the challenge looks like, it's not a mystery. We're not going to get to the end of the class and wait 5 weeks, and at the end of it I'll give you a test and I'll tell you what success looks like. How do we come up with multiple interesting ways to help kids understand what success looks like as they begin this process, so they know what it is they're changing? The teacher's role is to reduce that gap. And I have a lot of time for that notion of gap. Think of the concept of feedback, which is going to appear on this chart soon. Feedback works by finding out where a kid is, finding out where they're supposed to be, and then putting in the feedback to reduce the gap. And it comes back to this notion of goals, difficult goals and challenge. Our kids, for whatever reason, like challenge. I've spent, in fact, I think I can safely say that the team I work with over the last 20 years, we have the largest sample size of adolescents in prison, both male and females. They love challenge. In the same way that our academic experts, our computer nerds, our music scholars, our sports people, they love challenge. But hey, there's a whole nother group of kids in school that we have to turn on to the challenge of something. And so challenge is a key notion. Worked examples, a very simple way. And that means that if you show your kid a worked example of what the end product looks like, you've got a dramatic difference, 0.57, than if you don't show them. So exposing that kind of information. You may be surprised with direct instruction up there, but the key essence in direct instruction is two things. It forces teachers to talk about teaching. And it forces them to ask up front, what does success look like? I'm not talking about direct instruction you buy out of a manual. That misses all that. And then you can go on up the chart, and you can see some other kinds of notions there in terms of self-verbalization and self-questioning, because that's the occasion when teachers listen to what learning is happening. And one of my big themes is, how do we get teachers to not talk so much? Or as one reporter put it in the Sydney Morning Herald recently, academic tells teachers to shut up. I liked the letter in the paper the next day from a teacher who said, teacher tells academic to shut up. And going further up there, the most powerful, and you can see it's quite dramatically higher than anything else, is this notion of students' expectations. And one of my arguments is that the fundamental role of teachers is to raise student expectations. Don't ever allow them to set an expectation for themselves that you can't possibly raise. And that's your job. It's never to meet their needs. It's never to help them reach their potential. It's to help them exceed their potential. And I relayed the story this afternoon about Rod McDonald here, who was my supervisor, who saw something in me that I never saw in myself. He created opportunities. He created targets for me. He created incredible skills and exercises, and he poured in the assistance to help and make me do this that allowed me to have much higher expectations than I ever imagined when I first came here to OISE. And that's the nature of what I think is the power of teachers. That is so powerful that we should understand what the student's expectation. Now, of course that means we have to give them the confidence they're going to get there. Of course it means we're going to have to give them the skills and the understandings to get there. But hey, if I know anything, if teachers set low expectations, they will be the most successful teachers. And we need to turn that around. And all the rest follows from that. You can see down the chart there, response to intervention. Put in an intervention, ask about your impact. Provide formative evaluation to the teacher about what's happening. Create classroom discussions where you hear how the kids are learning. Feedback. And the biggest issue in feedback for me is how you, the teacher, get feedback about your influence. And so when I tried to sum up in a pithy statement what this is all about, it is in those phrases, know thy impact. And the argument that I put is if teachers go and school leaders go into a school and they start with that mentality and they wish to evaluate their impact, all else good things follow. And of course, that asks the question, impact about what? And like, take high schools. I'm not sure that for many kids in high school, literacy and numeracy is that critical. They've got it. Other things are much more important. For some kids, it may be critically important. And my point is that for different kids, different impact. But and evidence, which is a highly contested notion for me. And as I was saying to a few of you, you know, the question to ask is, what evidence that do we have that we have an impact? And that's a very debatable question, and so it should be. And when teachers start to debate that question and they start to have collaborative inquiry about that question, from that, we get better understandings of what challenge means. We get better understanding what progression. And I actually am horrified with most curricula. And we put people in a room, we call it, as we were saying before, we call it groupthink, and they decide on what the progression is. Now, you show me the evidence that kids progress that way. It's very, very hard to find. In fact, it's only in the last 3 or 4 years that groups have started to say, how actually do kids progress through these curricula? Not how do we think they do, not how should they, how do they? And my point is that the more we can listen to that, the more we can have success. So that's the big story. That's my mantra. When teachers see learning through the eyes of students, That's the first half, and that's what I spent 10 years in New Zealand working on. And the second part, which I've started now, is how do we help students see themselves as their own teachers? And all that jargon about metacognition and self-regulation and lifelong learning, I get lost in that jargon. That's what it means. In the schools I work with, 6-year-olds and 16-year-olds, our job is to help them become their own teachers, because that's what lifelong learning is. And that requires incredible skills in regulation, incredible skills in monitoring, incredible skills in understanding their impact when they're learning. And so one last slide. This is the key. My challenge is going to be to the group and the panel up here is sometimes I worry that I haven't got the words right. Like in the New Zealand, where I had a bit of influence on government policy, they liked this notion and they decided they would make all principals in New Zealand principals that attended to impact. But unfortunately, they decided to call them assessment leaders. And I think it's a very narrow notion what I mean. And so I lost that battle, so I realised that I haven't quite got it right yet. But it's this notion that if you go in, adult, and you worry about the impact, and you seek the feedback from the kids, and you worry about what it is you want to have an impact on, my goodness, the kids are the dividends. But if you go in, and you believe you're a facilitator, a guide on the side, you're the person to get through the curriculum, and the kids aren't high ability, or they come from low SES, and all those kind of things, if you believe that, you're in trouble, and so are the kids. Now, I'm not talking about the truth of it, except to say that I really enjoy, as I'm sure many of you do, going into the lowest SES schools here in Toronto and seeing teachers doing stunning stuff. And so every kid needs and deserves a year's growth. I think we know what a year's growth looks like. I think we can get it. And my biggest frustration that I have in this whole business is teachers are the first people not to acknowledge their own success. They love to give the credit to the kids, and I think that is killing our profession. It's allowing everyone to say when there is success out there, look at this kid, he did his homework, he put in the effort, he came to school and class, he did all this stuff. Hey, I bet there was a teacher in that equation. How's that for a starter, guys? All right.
Thanks, John. Mary Jean, I think we'll each take a moment to share some thoughts, and then we'll open it up to a bigger conversation.
Thank you. Well, and as a number of people in this room know, the pieces of the puzzle that I spend most of my time wondering about is actual implementation in classrooms across Ontario of those kinds of changes that will allow teachers to have a bigger impact on kids. And one of the pieces that I think's really exciting about teaching in this time is that we actually do have such a wealth of good, solid research now to inform practice. And we are in the process, I think, of building better knowledge mobilization and better sort of focus on actually turning that research into action in a lot of classes. But here, I guess, is the puzzle to me. You really describe a teacher in a very, very different way than a teacher's role would have been described 10 years ago, 20 years ago. Because what you're really talking about is that teacher who is very clearly focused on impact and outcome, whatever that, in whatever area it is they're looking, and that they bring that sense of reflection and question and action research to the table that says, okay, this is what I want to have as an impact. I'm going to be trying these different strategies with this group of kids or with these kids or whatever, and monitor whether that's working or not in that constant kind of change. So it's really very much more a teacher as an action research into action, action into research kind of thing. So here's my big puzzle out of all of this. How do you actually help teachers do that in a systematic way so that you don't have 12 classrooms out of 20 in a school that are moving down that pathway, or you don't have 45 schools out of 60 in a board that are characterized by that kind of professionalism and quality. Those are my puzzles. So my esteemed colleagues up here, I think, are going to answer all those questions for me.
So I hope you're taking notes, John, because we're going to have a combination here of things. And I must say that to start with, Ontario does have a love Hattie relationship with John.
Oh.
It's true. It's true. I have two comments to make. One is just an observation. The other actually is very close to Mary Jean's last puzzle. The observation, I know John would agree to this, is that any given effect size is affected by the variation in the quality of implementation of that particular factor. So if we take the school principal, school leaders, where the effect size is at a certain level, and let's say 3/4 of those principals are transformational leaders where they don't have much impact, and 1/4 of them are more focused on the principal as evaluator. If you were actually to do something that would reverse that, and you had many more principals acting as, in John's terms, evaluators, that effect size would go up. And so you have to be careful of the variation.
And as you know, it does.
Yeah, it does. Yeah, so it's not literal, and I know John would agree with that. But my question is similar to Mary Jean's. Now that we are getting a more fine-grained appreciation of the particular attributes that make a difference, and John earlier, I don't think he said it tonight, but in the 4 o'clock session, said that teachers don't make a difference, but teachers who have certain attributes do make a difference. So my question is the same puzzle question. And it's kind of asking John for his own theory of action. How would you go about getting more of those attributes in a given system than you have, let's say today, that you wanted more by way of strategy? And to give a little bit of some frame for that, Andy Hargraves and I just finished a book on the professional capital of teachers, where we talk about push, pull, and nudge. So this is about strategy for change. And it's a mixture of some people say, well, we can only get change if we push people into it. Others say, no, you have to pull them into a desirable process with good leadership, inspire them. And others even prefer nudge, don't even pull so hard. So in one sense, you could say that as you go from classroom to the government, I won't think of just Ontario, I think teachers prefer to be nudged. They don't want to be pushed or pulled. Probably administrators have a mixture of push and pull, and if you're in the government level long enough, you want to resort to push because it's not moving fast enough. So my question then is the same puzzle. We see these attributes, they're desirable and they're powerful and they're fine-grained, and if we wanted to increase the presence of them in a large system like Ontario, how would John, if you were an advisor here, suggest we go about that?
Well, the first thing I'd like to say is I want to say what a huge contribution I think John's work has made, and the deserved popularity of this book is because it's brought to our attention something that you read it and you say, well, you know, why haven't we been thinking this all along? Once you see it, you see how obvious that line is and how powerful it is. So I want to say a thank you for that. I think I want to add to Michael's, well, I'll come back to that in a minute. 2 points, I think. One, again, like my colleagues, education's a big and complicated system. And so to partly answer the question that you've asked, to get those changes in those high value, high yield things, you have to do a bunch of other things. And some of those things are, in fact, lower down the scale, and some of them aren't on that scale at all. Because it's a system, because it isn't just each teacher, it's teachers working in groups, although we think of teaching as being an autonomous activity, actually, in my view, it's an entirely social activity, deeply affected by group norms in schools and districts. So if, for example, to take the point about student expectations, which I completely agree with, if we actually wanted in a systematic way to work on helping teachers increase their expectations for students, we'd have to think about the structuring of courses, we'd have to think about the way leadership is organized, we have to think about support services in the schools, we have to think about assessment practices, because all those things are part of the social contingencies that shape the extent to which teachers can do that work. And so in that sense, things all are tied together, and we need to think systemically. One of the hardest things to do in any system is to get the pieces lined up so that they support each other. And what we typically have is we've got instructional focus over here, and we've got something else entirely happening over there. One of the best examples of that, Michael and I were doing some work in Queensland in Australia. And you know, the Queensland department's got a really good focus on teaching and learning. But their physical plant people sent out to school principals a 17-page survey on the state of their swimming pools. That didn't really help principals with the teaching and learning agenda, and I don't blame the physical plant people. They were doing their job as they saw it, but they did not have an aligned system in which all the parts were supporting each other to achieve the goal. So that's the first thing. The second one is, it's about the public mind, which we haven't talked about yet, and about what counts as common sense and about what people believe to be true of education. So it's a story I tell often about my premier in Manitoba, Gary Doer, when I was deputy in Manitoba, and we were having a discussion one day on an education policy issue, and I was trying to explain to him what I thought the research said about this, which wasn't entirely coincident with what he wanted to do. And he looked at me and said, "Ben, that might be true, but it's sure not what anyone believes." So because policy is made in that realm of common sense and public belief, we have to think about, this is one of the really important issues about John's work, how do we communicate this in a way that changes the public mind, the political context in which those decisions are made? You know, I'll just finish with this. Michael talked about push, pull, and nudge. But in the public mind, there's some other words that people want to use about schools, like kick or bludgeon, that he didn't have on his list. And the idea is, how do we get some words off the menu and some policy choices off and other ones on? To me, that's another really essential question that's going to be necessary to have some way of addressing before we can deal with the other stuff. But thanks very much, John. It was great.
Well, I think to start with, Ben, you should realize in Queensland that one of the critical things in swimming pools is, have you checked that there's no crocodiles on them?
That was on the questionnaire.
That's very, very real. And we're in this bind that all education is local, but we can't afford it to be. And, you know, these people are much more experienced at the policy side than I am, and certainly as I have done to a much lesser extent work with government and understand their push-pull notions and what their agendas are and how, unfortunately, very often that whatever the previous government did or said, the words must be different again. So that's part of the art of how you do this. And that's no different to where I'm at, is how do you get the right phrases and the right concepts to win the hearts and minds of the teachers, of the leaders and the politicians. And what I'm learning as I work in schools, and I have a team, and we're in a number of schools, a good 2,000 to 3,000 of them, that with all the modesty, we're saying, how do we make you a visible learning school? And we don't have a program, we don't have a silver bullet, we don't have a set of worksheets. And the first thing we do, and I won't look down the table here, because I normally say I stole it from Ben Levin, but today I'm going to say I give credit to Ben Levin, is his notion of success coordinators. And that when a school starts to work for us, at least a 0.5 senior person has to be the success coordinator. And one of the key jobs is to run this debate. And the first part of the debate is we have an evaluation, and those of you there on Tuesday and Wednesday, I showed it to you. It's not long, it's about a page. And we ask the question, what is the evidence that you can bring about each of these 7 or 8 questions? In the schools we work with, sometimes that's a 3 or 4 day job. If you ask them where they are, that's easy. It's just consensus, and that misses the point. Because what we want to do is we want to start the first question about what is their evidence of impact. And it's a very fraught discussion, and it shouldn't be muted. I'm supposed to nudge you. It's this notion that you guys are doing with collaborative inquiry. And if you look at the kind of work I'm trying to do, is how do we get teachers to collaborate about teaching, about impact, as opposed to about planning and assessing. And that's the key to me to upscale this notion. And the pressure I'm putting on both my learned colleagues down the line is that if you look at the research out there on upscaling or outscaling, there's very, very little of it. We really don't know a hang of a lot and how to do it. We do it and then say, oh my God, goodness, it worked. But actually to deliberately do it. So where I'm starting from is this notion of asking about the... Notice what I didn't say. I didn't go and say, what's your maths or English scores? I want to hear what they think evidence is. And the success coordinator then looks at and pushes this notion of progress. And I'm trying to push the Australian government, as I did the New Zealand government, to get away. They've reaped all the benefits out of the league tables and the level 1, 2, 3, 4s and getting the kids to there. And I can show right across the nation that when you come up with graphs of schools and their mean scores, it's an incredibly good predictor of the real estate. Now, there's nothing wrong with that, but it's not going to engender the change I want. And sometimes you have to do that first step to get to the second step. But the second step to me is this emphasis on every kid deserves a year's growth for a year's input. Now, I think I have a bit of a sense what that looks like. And that's what we do in our schools there. Well, is the impact that we're having of a sufficient magnitude that every kid can get a year's growth? And then the success coordinator's job, and I think this is one of our problems in education, we come up with policies and then we expect every teacher to be an expert of it. Success coordinator's job is to help construct the study. It doesn't have to be rich and rigorous and random control and all that. It has to be convincing to the group and do the collection of the data, whether it be performance or whether it be assessment or whatever, and do the analysis and then go back and construct the discussion, because it's the discussion what matters. Now, I've been doing this now 8 or 10 years and we're getting some big changes. But notice where the big changes are. All I'm doing is using a mechanism to create dialogue, which is no different to where you're at, but the focus is on growth. It is on growth. It is on growth. And then after a while, look, I'm not there yet, but I absolutely believe there is a practice of education. There are things that we can do that have a high probability of working, and there are things that we don't do. And that's a step that we have to get to. If nothing else, what I've done in New Zealand, what I'm trying to do in Australia, is to move the debate to a debate about learning. Get it away from resources, get it away from teaching, not because those are not important, you need those, but they're just precursors to. And that's a very healthy debate. But I have to end up by saying, and we've had discussions about this in other contexts, when is good enough, good enough? Sometimes we ask our teachers to do more, they do it successfully, then we come back and ask them to do more again. And I know that's the nature of our business because each year a new cohort comes in. But the teachers feel it's a beat up. The teachers think, you know, I could quote Michael Fullan endlessly about teachers being inert to change. And they don't mind change as long as it doesn't happen to them. And they're very good at listening to all these policies. And that's a kind of a hopeless situation. And so to me, one of the keys is to help the community and our sector understand. And to me that is, if you can systematically get greater for all kids, greater than a year's growth, I want to esteem you, I want to value, and I want you to appreciate that. Because in my experience, as I commented about between 4 and 6, teachers are loath to take credit for success of their teaching. They always see it as about bright kids, engaged kids, attentive kids, kids with financially gifted parents. Hey, we're pretty good at what we do. So how do we as a system pause occasionally and say you're doing a great job and allow you to continue to do it without all the next wave of change? Well, that's a good challenge.
Well, and I guess as I think about that last question about when is good enough, the truth is we're dealing with development of people and young people in particular. And so I guess where I see some contradictions in what you've put in front of me is that I don't think that celebrating success and recognizing high quality and achievement and growth means that you have to stop and be satisfied with that. Like, I really don't believe that. It seems to me if we talk about expectations for kids, we want teachers to have very high expectations for kids, because we want kids to have high expectations for themselves. And wherever a kid is, I think they can aspire to something better. That doesn't mean that you beat teachers up or beat schools up if they don't get there.
But if the locus in ownership is in that person.
Come on. If you said to an airline pilot, you know, you successfully got me last night from Vancouver to Toronto. Well done. But there's a new cohort of passengers tomorrow. You're going to have to do more training. It's not good enough, et cetera, et cetera. They'd give up.
Well, but the airline industry would say, if we're not figuring out how to do it better, the guys over there will, and they're going to be able to
but
offer
they know
it
what
more
being
effectively
good enough is good
and
enough.
Efficiently.
Moving on
no,
time,
I don't think they do.
Passengers, safety, all that kind of stuff.
And then Southwest Air came along and turned the industry around.
Absolutely.
Right. Well, so why aren't we able to aspire for something better?
If we are really good. If I could just interject, we have some roving mics out there, and looking out in the audience, I see people nodding and shaking their heads and looking worried, and so please, as we'd like to extend this conversation beyond the folks up here, so please raise your hand if you'd like one of the mics, and then Ben, go on while we...
Yeah, I think that... This is it's an important issue, but it's really an issue of, I think, framing. So I take John's point that we don't want people feeling that no matter how well they do, it's not good enough. But the flip side of that is that often the best people are completely motivated by achievement. And absolutely. Achievement is precisely their spur to want to do more.
Absolutely.
So we don't want to cut that off either, and I think that's Mary Jean's point.
But you don't need a policy for that.
Well, you do need some policy for it, if only to make sure that it's your policy isn't getting in the way of it.
Oh, okay, in that sense, yes.
Right.
But like, it's like Teresa Amabel's work. You know, in every business, most people are motivated by knowing they have an impact.
Yes.
Not necessarily by their salaries.
That's right.
Yep. I don't think we're very good at that with teachers.
So we're trying to build on that intrinsic motivation that people have, both kids and teachers. And, you know, I would say one of the really good things that's happened in many schools in Ontario, and I've seen it and talked to many teachers about it, is that the teachers feel that they are vastly more motivated because they are more successful. Mm-hmm. So they are probably working in their own, in one sense, harder, and yet enjoying it much more and much more motivated to try and go further. So that's, in a sense, as you talked about, okay, raising expectations, we're trying to do it for everybody, but it is critically important that we don't do it in a way that makes people feel no matter how good I do, it isn't enough, because that is demotivating for people.
But that's what I was hearing.
Not my intention.
Can I just interject here?
I was wondering if there has been any study on the effect of the misinterpretation of teaching strategies and the implementation of perhaps what might be termed as rote teaching. And what I mean by that is when teachers are told that they have to teach in certain ways, and they stop being creative, they stop taking perhaps professional responsibility for creating their own strategies. I don't know if you know what I mean, John.
Well, let me have a go, and then I'll pass to my colleagues. One of the things I got involved with when I was in North Carolina is, for various reasons, North Carolina was selling lots of turkeys to Israel, and they needed a reciprocal return. So they bought this package for teachers, and in various counties, they mandated that all teachers had to use this particular teaching method. And unfortunately, I was told by my dean that I had to be the evaluator of it. And I wasn't very interested because I took the line that the chances of success was zero. I surprised the hang out of myself. I watched some teachers that are horrifically bad, absolutely improved. They didn't get better up there. And I come back to the notion, I do think there are practices of teachers such that we should say these things are not good enough. But here's the killer. The problem that we have is that there isn't one best practice. Because if kids don't learn that way from that best practice, you need to do a different one. And one of my worries is the silver bullet notion that we're going to do discovery teaching or collaborative teaching or inquiry teaching. That's great for some kids. It's hopeless for others. And typically, unfortunately, what we say is, oh, those kids aren't very smart. We're actually not very smart because we don't realize we have to try a different strategy. So I'm not sure I'm answering your question, so I'll ask a colleague. Because I may have misinterpreted.
Well, I've been thinking about this a lot. And I think that we really want to elevate the status of teaching as a profession. So I think we want to think about teaching. Let's say we thought about teaching being a profession in the sense medicine is. So let's think about how it works in medicine. And some of you will have heard this analogy from me before. How it works in medicine is this, that when we develop a new technique for treating something, we expect all doctors to use it. We don't have doctors saying, you know, I started practicing before there was anesthesia in the days when patients were tough, and I don't hold with all this anesthesia nonsense. Right? And when we have arthroscopic surgery now, we don't have doctors saying, I don't like arthroscopic, I like to cut the whole knee open anyway. So the idea that people should have autonomy about their practice in a profession, I think, is preposterous. It's contrary entirely to what a profession is. But within the body of professional knowledge, there is lots of room for skill and creativity. So to John's point, I'm treating someone who I think has X and I try something, it doesn't work. Now what am I going to do? I'm not going to keep doing more of the same, hoping it'll work the next time, which is sometimes what we do in schools. So that's where the autonomy comes. But the autonomy is rooted in a deep knowledge of good professional practice. It's only when you know what the best current knowledge and practice is, in my view, that you have any right to autonomy. And to take a school example, let's take something like formative assessment. Right, or feedback processes. So I think we ought to be saying we expect those kinds of feedback processes to be used by every teacher in every classroom. But what they're going to look like in a particular classroom with a particular group of kids is going to vary. You have no autonomy to say, I don't believe in feedback, but you have lots of room as a professional to say, for these kids in this subject area, I need to adjust the way I do feedback. That's my notion. And so just to frame it in terms of autonomy of practice, I think is wrong.
Could I take, I agree with with that, and we might come back to it. But I wanted to take another question mark. I'm sure it's in your book, John, but the question is, what is effect size actually measuring? In other words, what's the content of learning we're talking about? Presumably, for example, you could get lots of data on literacy and numeracy, including in now in Australia with the NAPLAN data, all on literacy and numeracy. So and from what you said, your measure of effect growth is not literacy and numeracy, because that's too narrow. So if it's not that, what is it? Is it a moving target? How do you think about determining what I would call the dependent variable of effect size?
The criticism of my work, and it's very reasonable, is that sometimes I get obsessed with effect sizes and numbers, and I'm trying to say, no, they're indicators. For example, take my own subject, music education. Heaven help us if we start giving too many tests to kids that allows us to calculate means and standard deviations, etc. It's in the performance often. It's in the attitude. And the question that I'd ask those teachers if I was a success coordinator is, what would be the evidence of the impact of your teaching on this performance? And that is a very rich discussion, and it needs moderation, because that to me is the essence. And I take the line along with Ben. I don't believe it is a right of teachers to decide how big enough the effect is for a year's gain. I think that's a very contested notion, as it should be, and it should be a debate. And I want a hang of a lot more discussion in staff rooms, across associations, that says this is what it looks like to have typical growth in music performance. Now, heaven help us, I don't want to convert that to a number. What I do want to do is I want to do that across the curriculum, across how all the kids work, and I want to use a variety of sources of evidence to triangulate, of which one will be assessments in some areas and it will be effect sizes. And I include those in the equation, but it's like I was saying this afternoon, if that's all you got in your box, you failed. If you haven't got some in the box, you failed. I think the key issue is how we create the debate about what sufficient progress is. And of course, that should be informed by the curriculum. And of course, that we should give teachers resources, which I don't see in this part of the world, so they can regularly start to tap in to this notion of what sufficient progress is. That's a very underdeveloped area in this part of the world.
I think it is indeed an area that actually is under-discussed, and we do need to expand the debate around it. I do want to come back to that notion, though, of however you expect teachers to be saying, okay, what is my impact on the outcome?
And this business of teaching strategies. Ben's absolutely right. There are some teaching strategies that we know are not appropriate, and there are a whole raft of them that we know do have the potential to make a powerful difference in impact for kids. It seems to me that the essence of good teaching is to have a whole range of teaching strategies that we know about, and we know a lot about, and we know how effective they can be, and we know what it takes to make them effective, and we know which kids at which time and in which circumstances, so that the essence of a teacher's professionalism is being able to select an appropriate teaching strategy to meet the needs.
Before we go to the next question, let me ask both you and Ben a question. Mr. Jones, he's in my school. He's been in this school for 40 years. He's a crusty old bugger. He uses incredibly old-fashioned methods. He's got none of this modern stuff. He doesn't use any of this feedback stuff. But hey, when I look at the evidence of his impact, it's colossal. Would you change him?
Well, first, I would like to thank John for coming up today here and telling us these fabulous words. And I want to say that I agree with you in the sense that we teachers should have an impact on students. And I do believe that the new generation of teachers should believe in inspiring. Like, we teachers should be able to inspire other teachers on how to inspire the students to learn. Now, the question that I wanted to ask you is, I'm coming from a country in South America, Colombia, and I've seen that the class size is like 60 or probably 70 children in one classroom, and I've seen from personal experience that that class size is not that good for achievement, and I've seen the other extreme in other classrooms where there are like 8 children only, and I've seen the great impact on achievement as well. So my question for you, and especially for my country, what's your take on that? And do you think class size really matters in this case?
You can answer that. Oh, I hate answering that question. Oh, I just dislike that question intensely because I get so misinterpreted, which means that I haven't got my story right. But what I read the evidence is that watch the tense in the sentence. As we have been using smaller classes compared to larger classes, we have not shown a great impact. It's been much smaller than we expected. In fact, it's quite tiny. And relative to the dollars we spend on it, it's trivial. I'm trying to convince these guys down here, their mate Jim Waters, to do the analysis, to work out in Australia over the last 20 years, we've poured billions into reducing class size, and say, can you convert that to show what the increase in teacher salary would be if we had kept it the same, because achievement hasn't changed. But for you, sir, I think I need to be very careful. One of the things I say in my book is that my research generalizes to countries where the between school difference isn't very large. When you go to countries where, like South Africa, Germany, and maybe your country, where you've got massive differences between schools, then you've got to be very careful about interpreting my work. When I go to Hong Kong and I go to Taiwan and I go to Korea and I go to Japan and their typical class sizes are 60 and they're at the top of the world, they're doing something dramatically right. And I think the way I interpret the class size business is that unfortunately in the Western world, we have given for the last 200 years teachers an egg crate model of teaching that has about 30 kids in it, and they have stunningly worked out ways how to deal with it. If you're a man from Mars or a lady from Venus and you came to Earth and saw our egg crates, you'd be shocked about how absurd it is. But unfortunately, we've worked out how to do it. And like the way I read it, when I ask teachers what the optimal class size is, it's 5 less than the one that they've got, what they've got at the moment, as long as they choose that 5. I don't know what the number is.
So. Let me have a stab at addressing that question and using it to answer the previous question that John asked, which I thought was a really good question. The question, I think, for Colombia or any country in that situation is not, would you like to reduce the class size? The question is, if you have more resources available, what is the best use of those additional resources? That's always the question. So you can use them to reduce class sizes, or you can use them for other things. And I'm guessing, because I've been to Columbia, but I don't know the education system very well, I'm guessing that the answer in Columbia is going to be some combination of those things. Simply reducing class sizes, for example, if you don't have good teachers to put in those new classes, is not going to help you at all. You'll spend a lot of money and you might be worse off. So the issue is, what's the best thing to do next in your situation? That is partly a contextual choice guided by research, but it's probably not going to be in any setting just making classes smaller, because that by itself I don't think will get you very much. And I'm going to use that to come back to the question about what would I do with that teacher, because it's the same kind of thing. First, I would say, if I were trying to improve a school, I wouldn't be starting by trying to change a teacher who's getting really good results. I'd be starting somewhere else. But I would be trying to create a conversation in that school among teachers, with that teacher and other teachers, about what do you do, why does it get good results, what can other people learn from you, and what can you learn from other people?
Just one comment on the class size is just a footnote to what has been said, and John said it earlier today, is that every time you think of class size changes, not only is where do you put your resources, but there needs to be two things in that sentence. How are we going to reduce class size, and how are we going to teach differently? Yes. That has to be the same sentence, not two different questions separate. And because it's the structural changes never result in much if that's all it is, the structure. You have to get at the actual culture and behaviors that we're talking about.
Thanks. There was a question in the back, I think.
Thank you. The words that were catching my ear were the idea of creating a discussion amongst colleagues and creating conversations. What are the panel's thoughts on how to do that? I guess my question comes out, I feel that within the little work that I've done within schools, if we could create these conversations, it really would help us to achieve the sorts of impacts that you have so well described. But I've tried for the past 4 or 5 years to create some of these conversations, and that's not an easy thing to do. And I think we struggle within schools, we struggle in the political arena to have intelligent conversations. And it seems to me that the whole issue of dialogue, which it has been put on the table, is so difficult to achieve. Do you have any comments or thoughts on that for the panel?
Yeah, okay. There's a lot to that question, and it's I think very specific. Let me say something that sounds quite negative. I just mean to start there to get somewhere else. If you increase the dialogue among teachers who are already not getting success, you end up pooling each other's ignorance without knowing it. So that's the back door to get into what I want to say. There is a lot of evidence, and it's built into our strategies, that focused collaboration among teachers with some kind of methodology of inquiry, well-led, where teachers are interacting with each other, where there's a circumstance of non-judgmentalism and transparency of results and practice, those work. And those are the strategies that need to be promoted. And we need more and more leaders who can lead that, whether they're coaches or teacher leaders or principals or combination of student success teachers or coordinators. That's what this is about, is to move to more focused collaboration. It doesn't have to be restrictive, but it definitely needs a shape to it. It needs to be well-led, and it needs to have some purpose that you can determine, and you need to end up knowing, or know during the process as well as later, is it making a difference, and what are the issues? It might be debatable, but this is the heart of the strategy that works, what you're asking for, and there are a lot of examples, not only of schools that have done this, but districts that have changed their entire culture to be like this, and we think Ontario has changed its culture to be more like that.
And I would suggest
that one of the important entry points into that is, in fact, to begin the dialogue with the student's work and the student's thinking in the center of the table. Because if you ask teachers to come together and say, oh, I'd like you to share the good things you do, right? John's absolutely right. Teachers are hesitant to do that because they say in their own minds, well, I don't really do anything all that special that's worth sharing. I just teach, right? The kids do it or whatever. If the dialogue is about what a teacher does well or doesn't do well, then you set off all kinds of bells and whistles. But if you put a problem of a student's thinking and how you raise that student's thinking into the center of the table and invite teachers to come into that dialogue, you will be able to start that dialogue. And then I think once you build a culture in a school or among a group of teachers where that honest dialogue about that problem or that kid's work is part of that, you can then move the dialogue into broader problems of practice that the group share.
I'm very glad about the last question because it sets the premise for my question. We have been talking a lot about teachers and impact that teachers have in the classroom and what can teachers do to cause students to grow. But I'd like to think that teachers are just one half of the equation, so to speak. I'm not sure I've got that fraction right. Effective schools are determined by virtue of students' achievement. What are some of the challenges or dilemmas that principals and vice principals face as they try to engage teachers in some of these transformative practices that you have been talking about?
Well, I'll say a couple of things about that. Two right off the bat. The first is that people don't necessarily have the skill to do it. They haven't been taught to do it. They don't know how to do it. You know, most principals, well, all principals essentially start as teachers. So they're used to working with groups of kids on a curriculum. And then we put them into a job where they're working with groups of adults on something that isn't curricular in the same kind of way and where the power relationships are very, very different. People don't necessarily know how to do that work. It is a skill that people can learn, and we've actually put a lot of effort into helping principals learn to do that. So that's one thing. Do people feel comfortable about it in doing it? Do they have the skill to do it? And the second thing is that although we say that is the principal's job, we then fill up their days with other things. So one of the questions I like to ask in any organization is what gets people into trouble? Will you get in trouble as a principal in a school district because you're not getting a year's growth for a year for all your kids? Or will you get in more trouble because your budget numbers don't add up? And in most organizations, the second is going to get you into a lot more trouble than the first. In the same way that we could ask about kids in school, which kid is going to have more grief in a school? A kid who could do really good work, but is coasting by, but not bothering anybody, or a kid who does terrific work, but is very lippy and mouthy to the adults. In most schools, the second kid is going to get into a lot more trouble. So, you know, it's easy to be clear in rhetoric about what we expect, but lining up our rhetoric with our behavior in complex organizations, that is a really big task. And so that's the second thing I'd say that gets in the way for principals.
I want to flip it, not just to be positive, but to focus on that in John's research, it really does show the kind of behaviors that principals would be engaged in that would be more effective for what that describes. And when you, the point I'm going to make now, it's not a matter of time, it's how they spend their time.
Right.
So the time that is being spent on the lack of impact, what John talks about, the more diffuse transformative role versus a more focused role, that's a big difference in terms of its impact. How to get more of it, I think, is a system problem. And it, I just give the image that, and that the culture that I'm thinking about, because this is what we've been striving for and have lots of examples of. If you have a school district that has personnel policies that says, if you want to be promoted to a vice principal or principal in this jurisdiction, you have to have a track record as an instructionally focused leader. And then you kind of support that. But imagine now it building up. And the job description, I want to say it this way, for the school principal is you need to be focusing on two things. One is the student achievement agenda, better defined according to John. And secondly, developing other leaders who will contribute more after you leave, the leaders developing leaders. If you do that for 4 or 5 years in a row, you have a new kind of built-in system of sustainable leaders that are more like what we're talking about. There's still the problem of the overload, of too many distractions for principals. There's still the problem of the failure to get at what is meant by instructional leadership, so that it's neither too diffuse nor too lined up with checklist and classroom observation, and you don't really shape the culture of the organization. So I think we know a lot about that, and that there are barriers, but principals who are effective do that in some ways despite their barriers, and systems like districts that are effective start to expect and look for ways where they can support that development and get more leaders that are like that. Finally, I would say we had a big event 2 weeks ago, the Ontario Leadership Framework that Ken Leithwood has helped shape and the ministry has formulated. It has all kinds of good ideas and grounded research on what are the effective personal behaviors as well as organizational behaviors that actually get the high impact that we're talking about.
Can I just add one thing there? And I think the glass of wine I had earlier gives me the fortitude to say this. The first part of it, because I know what's down the table here, the first part of it is echoing what's just been said. A fundamental power of leaders is to choose the debates. And that's certainly what you're saying. But here's the part that we may disagree with. There has been an enormous amount written about change, right? And we know a tremendous amount about change. I think one of the things that has to be added to this debate is that it's not about change. I think it's the absolute wrong agenda. It's about growing success.
Right.
And so great... What?
Completely agree.
Great leaders in schools make it very clear what they value, and they create a coalition of the willing around the success and grow from that. And when others see that that's what it means to be good in the school, that's what it means to be in, as opposed to being mateships and other things, or that you're good at changing. So I think we need to change. We need to get rid of all those books in future about change and start talking about how we grow success.
Well, it... And
it's all right, because Michael can write 6 more by the end of the year.
You throw them away, I'll keep writing them.
Mary Jean, you wanted to add something?
Well, and I guess the thing I'd say about that, though, is that that image of principals who can create that success in their school, et cetera, is really good. But the truth is, they can't do that and sustain it if we don't come back to something Ben said earlier, which is how do you get the whole system to align, right? In other words, you need a school district.
We need to see it from you, too.
Absolutely. That's what I was saying. I mean, you need a school district, actually, that's going to set the right agenda for what gets rewarded and what gets recognized and what gets supported. And a school district can't do that if the ministry isn't at the table in an aligned way themselves.
Thanks for the question so far, and you know, we welcome more. I would just like to, though, take the conversation in a slightly different direction. John, you're the head of a research institute, and I'm intrigued by that image of you squirreling away more than, I think you said, 1,000 now meta-analyses, so not individual studies, but studies of studies. Based on all of that, where do we need more research? What are the practices that are under-researched?
Oh, look, I could wax lyrical on that. I think there's a lot of things we don't research, and I think that the notion of, for example, student progressions, I think that's an incredibly under-researched notion. I'm sick and tired of curriculum committees getting together and deciding for kids how they should learn and what progress on the basis of groupthink. Nonsense. And when I look for the work on how students actually progress, the first thing I find is that they progress in different ways depending where they start. So having a curriculum that prescribes doesn't make sense. The other thing that I'm stunned about is that I'm struggling to find any research on how we teach concentration, persistence, and attention. What we do these days is if kids don't have it, we drug them. And in the up to the 1960s and 70s, that was a big area of research, is how do we turn kids on to learning? How do we get them to deliberately practice? Mm-hmm. That's all going, gone. And I think the fad of all the other kind of teaching methods has taken it out. And so I think that's a dramatic area that we need to come back to. Concentration, deliberate practice, is a learned skill. It's something that can be taught. And so I think that's another area. But the other area that is the most massively under-researched, close your ears, Ruth, teacher education. When I ask, and I did this morning, when Linda Darling-Hammond asked, and when Betsy Becker asks, how many studies can we find between us all that have asked about the impact of teacher education on the students of our teacher candidates, at best we can find up to 100, at best. 10,000 institutions, at best, between us 100. That shows me the bankruptcy in that model. Now, I am a passionate believer that we can be great at teacher education, but I believe that we're losing the battle if we aren't the first to ask about the evidence of our impact on the students of our student teachers, and that's my current mission as a director of research.
Well, I do have to take issue there. I mean, the idea that universities would actually do research on our own practice, I find stunning.
Well, Ross Traub, when I was a student here, he said, if I can give you one piece of advice, John, don't do research on your colleagues.
Right.
Sometimes I forget that.
Right. I'd like to put, though, two more on the list. One is special education. We know virtually nothing about the impact of special education on progress. I actually had a student go searching, as you did, and we could find most of the growth in special education is now in two areas, learning disabilities and behavior, and we could find two studies in the world looking at the impact of learning disability and behavior management programs on student outcomes. And yet this is now 10, 12, 15% of school budgets, so I think this is an area. And the second one that's just struck me, because I've been doing some work on it for something I'm doing for the government of British Columbia, is buildings. Kids spend a huge number of hours and teachers in buildings, and we know virtually nothing about the impact of physical space on learning.
I got about five meta-analyses on that, Ben. And well, every one of them says the same thing. Like, Australia didn't go through the recent recession, and one of the things they did is they spent hundreds of millions of dollars on school buildings. And we've got some stunning architecture, because one of the rules was you can have the money, but you can't build a classroom. So good principals in their usual way have come up with incredibly innovative ways to building rooms, and as long as it doesn't have doors. And all the research that I read, and we have a whole centre that's emerged between the architectural school and us, and I say we've got enough meta-analyses, and I keep saying to the government and to my colleagues, don't do any more research on buildings, we know it has no effect. Turn the research around and say, you've got all these new buildings, Australia, how do we do research on optimising the opportunities to teach differently in them?
Well,
there's no research on that.
But that's what I'm talking about I'm talking about buildings. I'm not talking about the impact. We know something about lighting and heating and that kind of stuff. I'm talking about the way that space shapes, constrains, or enables teaching practice. And that we know very little about. In fact, there was the Victoria Department of Education just issued a report on this.
They did. That, very good one.
Yeah, that's right. But it basically says we don't know anything about it. That's the kind of report researchers love, of course.
I'll give you one more. You find me a single study in the world, a single study that asks about how we should select people to be teacher educators.
I was wondering if you could define what you mean by success.
Success. Oh, look, I think that's the question in town. And I think that, like, when I convince our education review officer, our inspection officer, to go into schools. When I worked with NCATE for many years, I said to them, that's the question you ask. You don't tell them that answer. And what you evaluate is that answer. And what you evaluate is the two questions. How good, what's the nature of the evidence they have about success, and what are they doing about it? And sometimes the evidence isn't good enough. Well, that's a dramatic reflection on that school. Sometimes the evidence they produce about success is so narrow. That's a dramatic statement about that school. And so the answer to your question, ma'am, is I don't answer that. I think I have a sense of what success looks like, and that is in the variety of evidence people produce about the impact that they're having on that. But I think the mistake we make is assuming that there is a linear set of things. If that was true, all the kids would be going in the same direction. And like, as I do in the work I do, particularly in the New Zealand context, you can be a successful water polo player, you can be a successful musician, you can be a successful plumber in a school, you can be a successful trade person. It's your four pathways. There are lots of ways. But the key issue is you want to ask the teachers to do it, because those are the ones, these are the people that have the mind frames, the understanding of success, and we need to understand it. Yes, now I want a conversation with them. Yes, there is a bit of an obligation on me to give them some examples of what success looks like, and I'm happy to do that. But I think it would be a mistake. I think one of the problems I have with when I have students doing theses is they suddenly think they should have a section on definitions. You read the thesis, and at the end of it, you know what they're talking about. You don't get into legislative linguistics. You understand what they mean by success. So I think it's the most powerful question in the room.
So I'd like to reverse the emphasis on that and say that going about it that way as a primary strategy, as the first strategy, is too slow and too cumbersome and too hard to interpret. And if you reverse it, and I'll use our own secondary school reform, and we are suggesting what success looks like. And it is increased graduation, but it's tracing it back to what are the innovative programs that produced the increased graduation. And Ben's book, More High School Graduates, with the four pillars. So I would say about success for secondary schools, is graduation going up? Do you have the four pillars implemented? First one is knowing, I won't give you the four, but first one is knowing where each and every student is in the place and in their progress and in their involvement in education. So we have those criteria. Those are the things we want to know, and we know them. We know what to look for when we're asking the question. Then I would go to John's and say, let's make sure we're not being too narrow. If we ask that question that John asked as a second question, you then open up what kinds of other measures would you find? So I put my money on more structure in terms of what we know in the first place, and then refining it so that you're not too narrow. Whereas if you reverse it and you go the open-ended or more, it's not open-ended, but it's more diffuse in terms of how to imagine it. It will take too long to get focus.
Let me confess a bit here, Michael, and that in the New Zealand system where teachers in high schools choose to units of work from about 10 to 12,000 units they're allowed to teach, they're all moderated, they're all available. And in the early days, it was a diabolical implementation because teachers had too much freedom to interpret success as they wished. And so one of the things I insisted they do, that given it's scored on excellent merit achieved and not achieved, that for every one of those 12,000 units, there is a worked example for each of them that shows what an excellent merit achieved and not achieved. There is a commentary about why this is excellent, not merit, not achieved, etc. And that's available to every parent, every kid, and every teacher. Now, the teachers were horrified because suddenly they thought that they couldn't teach this way anymore and it was cheating. But it's made a dramatic effect on the nature of how teachers understand success. And we actually use that to feed and fuel the debate in schools. Right. And it's like what we did at NCATE. You're right, Michael. We had to give them some examples, and we were terrified that they would actually just mirror them because they thought that's what we wanted back, and it would take away that notion that some kids don't work this way. So, yeah, thank you for the push.
Did we have a question over?
Hello.
That's gotcha.
My question was around, we're talking a lot about dialogues between teachers that could be important when they're talking about teaching and learning and about how that affects student achievement, as well how teachers can be evaluators to create those spaces with a real focus on student achievement and the impact of various strategies. And I was wondering what you thought about the role of professional associations in these improvement efforts and initiatives going forward.
I'll make a brief comment, and it's like in the New Zealand secondary school system, when they implemented NCEA, it killed the subject associations. And one of the key performance indicators I gave to the qualification authority and the government is that if they improve their system, those things will become very healthy again, because that's where the debate about success, growth, and everything happens. And it's the nature of that dialogue that is absolutely critical to inform that. So that's my starting point. And they did start to grow again. And I think it was part of, like, it's a very good question to ask, and I think you've answered it here in Ontario. What's the role of government to encourage professional associations? You're in an incredibly rare situation, in my opinion, because you have teacher associations who actually run professional development and inform policy. That's actually quite rare. Most of it's done by the unions, by the government, and that's it. So those associations, to me, are part of the health of the system.
I would certainly echo that. To me, it seems that the associations, professional associations by their nature, are to support the growth and development and learning of the profession. And to do that, they need to partner with, I mean, it's about this business of alignment in the system, so that everyone is actually contributing to the forward progress instead of holding it back or distracting it.
I want to make one comment, and that's directly to Ontario. Throughout the world, we look to what you have done with a sense of awe. Do you actually appreciate that?
No.
Not as much as we should, actually, John. You're absolutely right. But I guess here's my question, and it's going to be kind of the flip side of that. We have come an incredible distance. And I often say to people that, like, I remember clearly what life was like in Ontario schools 10 or 15 years ago, and the change is beyond that which I could have dreamt in my wildest imaginings. At the same time, though, that's a double-edged sword, because I'm acutely aware of the inquiries that come from all over the world about what we're doing and how we're doing it and so on, and so are Ben and Michael. They get to go and help people sort some of those out in other places. But that in and of itself could, in fact, perhaps start to undermine the very culture we're trying to create. And that is, if we're all running around saying, yeah, we know we've come this great distance and we've got it, then are we still open to that really healthy, robust debate? And I guess in my closing comment, I would say that your visit and your research, I think, has reinvigorated the level of discussion and debate that we can have in this province around all of those things, and it makes me optimistic for where we can go from here.
Well, it may be true that, John, when you got your PhD here 25 or 30 years ago, the condition was that you wouldn't come back for a quarter of a century.
Were you in charge then?
No, I wasn't quite in charge, but I was here. But seriously, the point I want to make is this is actually a very focused agenda, and the people around the world are connected. That, and it's no accident that you're here. It's no accident that when you came, five different groups wanted your time. It just came out of the woodwork of doing that. That's predictable. And so this is really a part of building and building and building, and we're getting more precision. John's work is fantastic in that respect, and this is an ongoing development. It's not just a one-shot, one-week visit.
Yeah, I think we're at a really, really exciting time in education, not just in this province, but worldwide, building on what's been said. You know, one of the things that we need to remember about John's fabulous summary is that most of that research is fairly recent. And, you know, we couldn't, like, we've had a... It's only in, I would say, in the last 10 years or so that we started to have enough robust knowledge from research to inform practice in a good way. But at the same time as we're doing that, we are building on our knowledge base, although there's a ton we still have to learn, and we're building on that and making better use of that. I also see us at the same time elevating the status and importance of professional knowledge and professional practice. So it isn't that once we have research, we'll know everything. It's that while we're learning from research, we also have better teachers, better professional practice, more engagement with evidence, and it's the bringing those two things together, which is the heart of John's message, I think, that is going to get us the further improvement that we want and need to have for our children.